Welcome to UO Today. I'm Paul Pepis, director of the Oregon Humanities Center. My guest today is Vijay Gupta, violinist with the Los Angeles Philharmonic. Gupta joined the orchestra at age 19. He is an advocate for the redemptive and regenerative presence of music in ostracized and stigmatized communities. Gupta founded and serves as artistic director of Street Symphony, a nonprofit organization dedicated to bringing free live music to homeless and incarcerated men, women, and youth. As part of the 2016-17 Humanities series, the Oregon Humanities Center presented Gupta's talk, The Citizen Artist as Healer, at the U of O in Eugene on February 9th, 2017, and the following evening in Portland. His lecture was this year's Tzedek Lecture in the Humanities. Thank you, Vijay, so much for coming on the show, and let me thank you for that lovely piece that we ran at the top of the show. Let me ask you first, tell us about that piece.
Well, thank you so much for having me. It's a pleasure to be here, a real honor. That was a slow movement from Bach's Sonata in C major. And it's a really special and poignant movement because you always hear at least two lines the whole way through. And it sometimes sounds like two or three violins playing at one time, which is a challenge. But this is one of the very few sonatas that we actually know Bach performed himself. So he was actually writing it for himself. So that says a lot about him, not only as a composer, but as a violinist too.
Very cool. And while we're talking about that, tell us about your instrument.
So this is a 2015 instrument made by a Los Angeles-based luthier named Eric Benning. And it's a really gorgeous copy of a Bergonzi violin, and Bergonzi at the time had just taken over the same bench that Antonio Stradivari was working on. So the original instrument is actually assumed that the front face plate made of spruce was actually made by Stradivari, which would be really something special. But this instrument is remarkable, and I feel really privileged to just sort of be the first person to get her going, you know, and hopefully she's around for much longer than I am.
Well, I hope she feels privileged too. So why don't you tell us a little bit about your background and describe your trajectory to becoming a musician? That's an interesting story.
Sure. So I started playing the violin a little bit before my fourth birthday. Of course, I was a Suzuki child, so I went through the Suzuki system. I also had very dogmatic and determined Bengali Indian parents. And so I think that their first experiences of immigrating to the US were surrounded by a lot of closed doors. Mm-hmm. So they forced open as many doors as they possibly could for my brother and myself to make music. So my dad literally stalked Zubin Mehta all over Europe because he was a travel agent and he could just spend his miles doing that. So I actually played my debut with the Israel Philharmonic when I was 11 in Tel Aviv. I was lucky enough to study at the Juilliard School with some really remarkable teachers, and I had the beginning of this kind of solo career where I was playing recitals and playing with orchestras, and music was my lifeline. Music was this form through which I was really seen and heard in ways that weren't allowed even in my home. Mm-hmm. Yeah, music was my refuge and continues to be my refuge. Of course, as an Indian kid with the last name Gupta, my parents wanted me to be a doctor. And so I started going to college when I was 13. That wasn't entirely my choice, but I studied bio-premed. And I was really fascinated by music and the brain. And ultimately, I feel that music chose me because I spent 2 years studying music in New Haven and then didn't know what I wanted to do. So I took an audition for the LA Philharmonic, expecting fully that was like my last hurrah as a musician, and they offered me a trial week.
And you were 19 years old.
I was 19.
The youngest ever to be hired,
is that
right?
There was one person who was younger than me about 50 years ago, so for all intents and purposes, yes. But I think I'm more shocked now to think about a 19-year-old auditioning for a major symphony orchestra and winning the job. But that group of people have become my family. The LA Philharmonic is my community. And you know, I studied with Glenn Dichterow, the former concertmaster of the New York Philharmonic. And it was surreal to walk into an orchestra where not only had Glenn Dictorow started his career, but that Glenn Dictorow's father was the principal second violin. Harold Dictorow was the principal second violin of the LA Phil for nearly 50 years or more. And there were colleagues in the orchestra who are still in the orchestra who knew my teacher's father. So, I mean, talk about lineage and legacy. And these musicians mentored me in the most generous and gracious way. And I feel like my education has just begun, even 10 years in the orchestra.
Tell a little bit more about the experience and the power that you get from this performing in that context. Why is playing music so important to you?
Oh. Playing music is a chance for us to enter an emotional space that we can frame as redemptive. Mm. You know, it's a chance for us to belong. It's a chance for us to be seen and be heard. And if we do it right, if we do it right from here, we have the opportunity to connect over the span of centuries, and possibly over the span of various cultures and aspects of our humanity. And it's not necessarily that music is the universal language. Mm-hmm, you know, we say music is a universal language and we're usually playing Beethoven. and so there is this understanding and approach that music unlocks our emotional self and offers it in a way that is really a gift to an audience. And if we embody the selflessness that music allows us to inhabit, then I think we unlock parts of our humanity.
So that's a wonderful segue into my next question, which is, tell us what led to your founding of Street Symphony. I mean, you've already begun to tell us, so why don't you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, so I grew up in a pretty orthodox Hindu family. And one of the tenets that I took away as part of my identity as a Desi and a Hindu is that we worship through service, you know, and music in the old ancient Sanskrit tradition is a form of worship, of what we call sadhana, of dedicated practice. And so here I was as a 19-year-old in this amazingly privileged job playing on Bunker Hill at Walt Disney Concert Hall. And I just started to notice the epidemic of homelessness. And honestly, I started to feel like a hypocrite. I started to feel that if I ever had the desire to be a doctor, I didn't have to go to Haiti or Ethiopia or India. Public health works were needed in downtown LA, big time. And so I was battling with this kind of dissonance between being a musician at the highest level and also being called to serve and not finding the bridge to serve through music. And so the bridge for me was a gentleman named Nathaniel Ayers, who was the subject of a book in a movie called The Soloist. And I was lucky enough to become one of Nathaniel's instructors, and we started lessons at Disney Hall. And then one day I saw him wandering the streets, you know, and playing in the Second Street Tunnel in downtown LA. And I almost crashed the car, you know, because here was this, again, this dissonance of I'm asking a homeless, mentally ill black man to push a shopping cart up seven blocks from Skid Row to Bunker Hill so that he can take a lesson with me, because that's where I feel comfortable, right? Talk about privilege and practice. And so I started going to Skid Row. And Nathaniel opened that door to understanding that music had a place, whether it was in the concert hall or outside, you know, and the conversations we had through music made me start thinking about other Nathaniels. How many more Nathaniels are out there? And in the course of Street Symphony's work, nearly 200 concerts in the last 5 years in shelters and clinics and county jails in Los Angeles County, we've met hundreds of Nathaniels. They're out there.
Tell us what the reception that these men and women have given you?
Well, you know, at first, these concerts were concerts. They're mm-hmm. performances. We take great quartets by Beethoven and Brahms and go and perform them. And at the ends of concerts, we'd have this raucous applause. I remember taking some music by Bach into a men's jail. And these heavily tatted guys, you know, with the teardrop tattoos, standing up with real tears coming down their faces. And you know what? They received us with such heartfelt, authentic generosity mm-hmm. that it took my breath away. This was the kind of response that we felt alone in our isolated practice rooms. You know, I feel that Bartok is heavy metal, you know? And the only time where I felt that mirrored back to me has been in a jail.
Huh. Fascinating, fascinating.
Yeah.
So have there been, are you aware of any kind of longer term impacts that your sharing of this music has had for any of these underprivileged, incarcerated, mentally ill people?
Well, I can tell you what it's done for us as musicians. Mm-hmm. It's given us a different insight into what our role is as citizens mm-hmm. and healers and artists mm-hmm. in our world. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, we play for a very transient community, so it's rare that we'll see the same group of people in a county jail again. Mm-hmm. Los Angeles County jails are the largest county jail system on the planet. They're effectively also the largest psychiatric institutions on the planet because mm-hmm. our de facto treatment of mental illness is incarceration. Yeah. However, within the homeless community, one of the new initiatives for Street Symphony is to really lean in and become part of a community, which is why recently we had our second annual sing-along of Handel's Messiah in Skid Row. And the Messiah was actually first written to release 142 men from debtor's prison. And it was when it was performed in London, it was performed at an orphanage. And so there's this long history of social justice in music, especially with the Messiah. So we actually trained and worked with communities in Skid Row, with singers in Skid Row, coached them with, you know, singers from the preeminent Los Angeles Master Chorale, and they were our soloists. Huh. Our soloist who sang the Comfort Ye aria of Messiah was a Desert Storm combat veteran who was so hypervigilant that he couldn't close his eyes to go to sleep at night. And the power for this man to step in front of his own community and say the words, "Comfort ye, your warfare is accomplished," that brings Handel back to life.
Fascinating, really amazing. You're speaking so eloquently about this question, but I'm going to ask you anyway.
Please, please. You've
already made clear why, for you personally, social activism is important. I'm especially interested, I direct the Oregon Humanities Center, in any cases where we can see the power of the arts to advance social justice. And say a little bit about why you think the arts are so important for that project.
Because the arts are immediate. Mm-hmm. The impact of the arts are immediate. And if we need something immediate, we need it right now. We need it right now. We don't have the luxury anymore, as some of the most privileged, well-educated people on the planet who have been able to sit alone in a room playing Bach and Mozart and Beethoven for our own joy and benefit. We don't have the luxury to sit on the sidelines anymore. And so I feel that with our intention to create community, to create culture, to propagate movements, our voice is imperative in these conversations. And it's not only imperative to finding new and exciting venues to play Bach and Beethoven, mm-hmm. but it's also for us to step into a place where we're vulnerable to, and to inhabit a space as creators, to tell the story of our communities now. Mm-hmm. The reason why we play Bach and Beethoven today is because the stories are the same. They were mobilized around their own communities. We as musicians are natural organizers. So now it's on us to ask the questions, what are we going to get ready to organize for? Mm-hmm. You name it. Huh. We're ready.
Okay. So tell us a little bit about your collaborators, your co-founders, the people that you work with in Street Symphony.
Yeah. So my title in Street Symphony is as artistic director, but truthfully, there are quite a few artistic directors. We're very lucky to work with a wonderful ensemble of singers from the Los Angeles Master Chorale. We're also working with a great jazz band, freelancers from all over LA, colleagues of mine from the LA Philharmonic. We now have a roster of about 40 or 50 musicians. There's also an amazing influx of young musicians who are graduating from schools like the Colburn School or USC Thornton School of Music, who are just ready, you know. And frankly, I feel that, the rate of acceptance into national major league symphonic orchestras is 0.5%.
Right,
you've got a 10-time better chance of starting a nonprofit of your own and a 10-time further chance of getting into an Ivy League school.
Sure, yeah.
So the idea of making music for a cause is really, really critical right now. Street Symphony was co-founded by a gentleman named Adam Crane, who's the current vice president of external affairs at the St. Louis Symphony. And Adam was the one who actually picked up the phone and invited Nathaniel and Steve Lopez, the LA Times writer, to come to a rehearsal at Disney Hall. Mm-hmm. And so, much of this work is deeply rooted in the experience with Nathaniel and the community around Nathaniel. But I feel that our role now as an organization is to take all these talented musicians, create the context for a conversation to happen, and then back out. Mm. Still hold the container, but to welcome the Skid Row community, to welcome the incarcerated communities we work with, to step into this place of agency, to say, you belong here. You have a voice that matters. You have a story that matters. And you have a life that matters, too. Mm. And I think inherently in that, our artistic decisions are feeding our social decisions as well.
Huh, fascinating. Have you contemplated the prospect of becoming music educators for these people, for these communities?
Very much so. That's the next step for us. So our new initiative this year is to actually appoint a number of teaching artists from within the Street Symphony community who are professional music makers and educators themselves and pair them throughout the entire year with specific members of the Skid Row community. Mm-hmm. And actually, we have a composer on staff, we've got a number of singers, we've got a cellist, and at the end of the year at Messiah Project, they'll all be soloists. And so the representation of the work and the community has to come from the community itself.
Have you found any interest in other parts of the United States or other parts of the world to start similar organizations?
Oh, hugely, yeah. Earlier this week, I had an amazing conversation while I was here in Eugene with members of the Eugene Symphony, you know, and members of the board, of the orchestra, of management, to serve the community right here, you know, people experiencing poverty or homelessness or mental illness issues. I was recently in St. Louis, and the St. Louis Symphony is doing something similar. One of the goals for us at Street Symphony is to start a kind of fellows program. So we have folks who are coming in to spend time with us in Los Angeles, see how things are done, but then go back to their home communities and find out who they want to serve and find out who wants to be served in this way. I think that there's a huge draw to this work and a lot of interest. There's also a lot of closed doors, you know, and I think the closed doors come from both the side of the musicians and from the side of our prospective audiences and the organizations that represent them, because there's this sort of discord of not really understanding how music fits into service. Huh. You know, there's the question of, well, why shouldn't we be serving soup or giving socks or making scarves? And you know what? We should be.
Right.
But if we can not only sustain the life of a person, but also sustain the lives of all of us to understand what we live for, that's what the arts can do.
So you've spoken about the prospect of an education program, a fellows program. Are there any other programs that Street Symphony is contemplating?
Well, the overarching program is the idea of what it means to be a citizen artist. You know, and that is fed by all the strata of the Street Symphony communities right now, whether it's folks in Skid Row or in the jails, or the deputies who are the guards at the jails, or the judges, or the head sheriff. You know, the arts give us this context to be involved and be active, but also to step back and observe and to analyze. And I think one of the questions that we're asking to our core team of musicians is, as we're showing up for these marches, as we're calling our senators, as we're doing the organizing work and donating to the ACLU, how do we also spend time with each other and nourish the artistic connection so that we're replenished by this work as well, if that makes sense.
So you say, you know, to observe, to step back. So tell us what you've learned about the homelessness crisis in America. Tell us what you've learned about the prison industrial complex. What have you learned?
We ostracize and criminalize the most fragile and vulnerable members of our society because we have shut away the most fragile and vulnerable parts of ourselves. And I think that we see the homeless man pushing a shopping cart on the side of the street and we say, that could never be me. And so we push that man away instead of inviting him in. We make policies that criminalize poverty because we don't want to experience it ourselves. Or we don't want to experience the stigma that comes with it. And I think we experience that shame, that unworthiness, much more than we're willing to take account for. It's the arts that allow us to get in contact with those most fragile and vulnerable parts of ourselves, because those are the parts that define us as being human. It's our brokenness and our desire to belong that allows for some of the greatest works of art to exist, whether you're talking about Schumann or Van Gogh. So it's been an amazing learning. It's also been an amazing learning to learn about policy, to learn that there are not two sides, there are 2,000 sides to things. We don't see what the deputies see. You know,
right.
We're also not seeing what the communities of black and brown people who have been over-policed and tortured for generations are seeing. So I think it's our job as artists to ask questions and to tell stories.
So given all these experiences you've had, obviously you've thought very deeply about this, but not all of us are artists. So do you have any advice for people who want to be engaged meaningfully with their communities, who want to address issues of social justice through their own agency, who can't play the violin as you can?
Well, I'll push back a little bit, because I do think we are all artists. I think we come into the world as artists. And I think that what stops us from being creative is that somebody said, oh, that's not quite good enough. So we should embrace our natural inherent birthright to create. We can also show up. That's the biggest thing. Show up. And whether it is showing up to serve soup in a soup kitchen, do it. And show up to community and show up to yourselves. And I think that so much of the ache in the world is for people who are not seen and not heard. And so much of what our role is just to show up and see them and hear them and notice how we change when we are seen and heard as well.
Well, we've got, I wish that was the last question, but it's not, because it was such a great answer. We have 2 minutes left. You've already told us about all the various things you do. What's the next big thing that you want to accomplish?
That's a big question. I want to understand what it would be like to give creative agency to people who have been voiceless for a long time. There have been so many audiences in the jails or in the shelters who have leapt at the opportunity to be part of a little musical exercise, to sing a tune to their name, you know? And they do it with fearlessness and this kind of childlike glee, not to infantilize people who are experiencing homelessness or incarceration, but there's a joy there. And I think that we have a lot to learn from that joy. And so I want to empower people to become creators. And I feel like my job is to meet them and to transmute my skills and my opportunities as a musician to meet their creative voice. And that's a journey that I'm really proud to be taking the first steps on.
Well, I want to thank you so much for coming and visiting the University of Oregon and sharing your journey and your very passionate and very powerful reflections on these important issues. Thank you so much, Vijay.
Thank you so much for having me. What a pleasure. Thank you.
I've been speaking with the violinist Vijay Gupta, founder and artistic director of Street Symphony, a nonprofit organization dedicated to bringing music to homeless and incarcerated men, women, and youth. As part of the 2016-17 Humanities series, the Oregon Humanities Center presented Gupta's talk, The Citizen Artist as Healer, at the UO in Eugene on February 9th, 2017, and the following evening in Portland. His lecture was this year's Tzedek Lecture in the Humanities. Thanks so much for watching.